Thank you very much, sir, dear madam, and our colleagues. Today I'm going to discuss about alcohol withdrawal for medical officers, and we'll see whether we can do it in a short time, like in 5 minutes. During this time, I'm going to discuss all the important aspects of alcohol withdrawal for the medical officers. So first of all, we'll think about this person who's Vimal. He wants to stop his alcohol use following development of alcohol withdrawal seizures during a past hospital stay. And he is determined to stop alcohol and he's asking your help to stop, right? We will take this case scenario, and at the end, one of y'all can come out with a very good management plan for this person. Right, how to help someone who is willing to stop alcohol in 5 minutes. So when someone is coming with alcohol related issues, first of all, be aware, they are coming with different presentation, right? Sometimes patient can simply come and tell something else completely different and you will miss that, right? So you may accidentally find withdrawal symptoms during lockdown. So if they're admitted due to medical reasons, right? So this shouldn't be actually due to complete abstinence of alcohol, maybe relative or absolute reduction. Okay, so the most important thing in the management setting is to ask about the last drink. So all our management will depend on that, right? The first important thing is ask when he has taken the last drink, right? So the alcohol withdrawal doesn't come as a single symptom. It always comes as a cluster of symptoms. So as you all know, right, these four categories are very common, right? People develop symptoms in different time periods, right? Soon after you stop alcohol, if you are taking high quantities, after about 3 hours, 6 hours, you will start developing tremors, anxiety symptoms, insomnia, right? The seizures usually comes after that. And in severe withdrawal, some people get hallucinations and the severe withdrawal symptoms, which may be lasting for 1 week. And the delirium tremens also, it comes usually after seizures, right? The time duration I'm talking about. And all these symptoms can go for 14 days, the withdrawal symptoms, right? So be aware of the different presentations in different time intervals, then you know what to manage, right? We'll talk about early alcohol withdrawal symptoms usually starts in hours, right? That's why people wake up in the morning and run to have their drinks, right? So to avoid these withdrawal symptoms. So the agitation, anxiety, irritability are common, right? Tremors, sweating, and nausea, vomiting, tachycardia. And sometimes you can see hypertension. And these are very common things. And the peak is in the first day or the second day, it goes to a peak and comes down. These are early and minor withdrawal symptoms, right? So in management of alcohol withdrawal, we use benzodiazepine. So the rationale for using benzodiazepine is both, if you can see this receptor, so both are acting on the same receptor. So instead of giving something in the withdrawal of alcohol, as it is dangerous and life-threatening, we are giving something similar to that to avoid the withdrawal symptoms and go for a smooth recovery. So the assisted withdrawal is important. And how to identify whether this patient needs inpatient withdrawal or outpatient withdrawal is very important. To identify that, there are two different presentations, like complicated and uncomplicated alcohol withdrawal, right? I will deal with that in the next slide. And you need inpatient withdrawal if the patient had past complicated alcohol withdrawal status, which I would describe in the next time. Next slide. And if the patients are having comorbidities, if the patient is old and not having enough support, yes, you have to go with inward alcohol withdrawal. And sometimes patient may be taking a lot of substance, right? So be cautious and admit them. Most of the time we use Librium, which is chlordiazepoxide, widely available in our setting. And sometimes some people use diazepam. And if patients are having liver problems, we use short-acting ones, oxazepam or lorazepam. I think all these things are quite familiar to you all. And I will mention about the doses because it's very important. We have seen if you not treat them adequately, these people develop seizures or delirium tremens while having this detoxification, if you're not treating them adequately, right? So in moderate alcohol dependence, at least 20 milligrams of chlordiazepoxide 4 times a day is necessary. But severe withdrawal, remember 40 milligram of chlordiazepoxide plus another 40, and even you can go to a maximum of 240 milligrams, right? So we'll discuss about severe alcohol withdrawal. So in severe withdrawal, or the complicated one, could be either generalized tonic-clonic seizures or delirium tremens, right? The time intervals I mentioned earlier. So if it is the first seizure, you have to investigate and see whether this is a true alcohol withdrawal seizure or not, right? If the patient has previously developed, even you can give prophylactic benzodiazepines after you admit the patient. Phenytoin prophylaxis is not advised, and short-term anticonvulsants should be used. You can't prescribe anticonvulsant forever, right? Remember to tail it off when the patient is coming out from the seizures, right? And the delirium tremens, a medical emergency, actually, ideally, it should be managed in ICU setting, but we manage in normal medical ward setting. And usually onset is after 72 hours of the district, and it's rapidly developing, right? And that's the nature of delirium tremens. When you go, when you're doing your ward round, when you see your patient, if the patient is not having a proper orientation, if the consciousness is changing, and if the patient is seeing vivid visual hallucinations like snakes or somebody is coming and eating them and all this, usually it's in animal contents, and then you know the patient is going through delirium tremens, and the tremors are not fine, they're having marked tremors. And the autonomic dysregulations, delusions, agitation is very common. So then you know it's a medical emergency if the patient is coming at that stage. Delirium tremens, usually the onset is a little bit late. And the take-home message is it is dangerous. It's life-threatening situation. Usually about 5% of people who are on withdrawal can develop, and the mortality is 10 to 20%. That's why it is considered as medical emergency. And if the patient is unconscious, you have to treat with IV diazepam, IV thiamine. And don't forget thiamine. I think you all may have taught very well at medical schools about thiamine, right? If you don't give with thiamine, the patient can develop Wernicke-Korsakoff syndrome. And don't forget to investigate these patients about the other causes as well as you have admitted the patient. And look for the concurrent medical illnesses, right? Always remember, if patients have developed previous alcohol withdrawal seizures or delirium tremens, so you need to treat involved, right? So there's no point treating or detoxifying patients if you don't have a plan for this person, right? The patient is highly motivated, but you can detoxify and send without any psychological intervention, but it's in vain. No any benefit even to the patient nor the doctor, right? So always have a management plan with them. Psychological support is necessary. Even though you don't decide to start any medication afterwards, you have to refer them for psychological therapies. Otherwise, they can't maintain this, right? Frequently, they will come in with the same story, right? So then you will think it's your fault, right? So there are stations in outpatient setting. I mean, most of the hospitals are now empowered with the MO mental health, and other services are there. So always try to remember, don't think this is useless. This patient is coming over and over again and telling the same story. I'm detoxifying and sending. So always have a plan. And these are the medication that should be start with the psychosocial interventions, right? just by merely giving these medications won't do any good, right? Can't prevent anything. So there are a few take-home messages in this presentation. Alcohol withdrawal is potentially life-threatening, so be aware of that. Unlike heroin, it is different. And you should be able to predict whether this man is going to have a complicated alcohol withdrawal or not, right? So if you're doing alcohol withdrawal as in outpatient setting, you can get them to your place quite frequent and watch their symptoms, right? And titrate equilibrium doses. Okay, if the patients are becoming too drowsy, maybe they are going for hypoactive delirium. So ask to bring the patient immediately, right? Don't unnecessarily detoxify patients if you don't have a plan, if you don't send this patient for psychological services, right? So if the patient is not motivated enough also, there's no point doing it and postpone it and again get down the patient and do it. So I would like if someone can come from the audience and mention about this management, give us about management plan for this person, Vimal, who wants to stop his alcohol use and he has had past withdrawal issues, right? And he's determined to stop alcohol now. Or else, do you have any other questions related to alcohol withdrawal?
There's a question, Prasanka. What is the place of gabapentin in alcohol withdrawal symptoms?
Sorry.
What's the place of gabapentin in alcohol withdrawal symptoms?
We actually don't use gabapentin. And we are using long-term, long-acting Librium. That is because it doesn't have much addictive properties. That is the reason. And we don't want to have alcohol withdrawal seizures or delirium tremens. That's why we use. Now, you may think why we are giving Librium so frequently, right? So it has a very long T-half. So, but we are giving four times plus PRA. That is to avoid that. And we are not giving gabapentin.
There is a comment, it's not actually a question. Person Narada Varna Surya states that having never been involved in management of withdrawal symptoms for hard drugs like heroin, I had assumed that they would be as bad as or even worse than alcohol, and that there was a definite risk of seizures and really even death. It was really good to be re-educated on this point by excellent presentation on this subject.
So, yeah. Thank you, sir.
And there's a question. What is the place? Sorry. Please advise on use of thiamine. Is it overplayed? Should we prescribe it?
Is it?
Is it overplayed? I mean, are we putting unnecessary emphasis on it, or is it really
important? No. It is necessary because of so many reasons, right? Don't forget thiamine, because these patients are not taking enough vitamins when they are using this habit, right? When they're having this habit. So by the time when the patients usually come with dehydration, right? In case of emergency, IV fluids are a must, right? If you give dextrose finish, no, the patient would develop the dextrose the cycle, the Krebs cycle uses thiamine to metabolize it. So if you don't give, the patient will end up with vernicocorsacop. It is actually we are not giving sufficient thiamine most of the time.
I think you were originally expecting answers to this task, or
yes.
Madam, Horana, Dr. Praneet.
Okay.
I have worked for Mitrupia, sir.
Okay.
Madam, when considering alcohol withdrawal and giving some oral medication, to supplement for thiamine, is it okay to give vitamin B complex oral tablets? And what is the dose?
We are giving Neurobion in most of the instances. And the actual dose now for heavy alcohol withdrawal, it's about 100 milligrams. to 200 milligrams. So you can supply with neurobion.
Yeah.
But
that is oral.
Oral. So in oral setting, right? You're asking about oral outpatient treatment, isn't it?
Yeah. Do we have to supplement with folic acid as well, madam?
Actually, we are not doing that. Folic acid is not mentioned anywhere, right? In this alcohol withdrawal management.
Yeah. Madam, giving diazepam 10 milligram TDS, is it okay?
Yeah, some people use diazepam when you don't have librium. But out of those two, if you get a choice, better to use librium, which is chlorodiazepoxide epoxide, because it doesn't cause much addictive nature like diazepam. That's the reason that we are giving. And when you have to give IV, of course, in a severe delirium tremens or whatever, anyway, the choice is diazepam. Otherwise, if you have a choice, yes, go for librium.
Okay, madam. Thank you very much, madam.
You're welcome. So what about this person's management? Was I very fast? Because I wanted to finish it 5 minutes.
I think it is very clear. So maybe questions.
Yeah, there is one suggestion from Dr. Randika Fernando. First, need to investigate this patient's seizures. Then have to assess whether he's moderate or severe dependence. So that was one answer here.
Sorry?
First, need to investigate this patient's seizure.
Yeah.
Then have to assess whether he is moderate or severe dependent.
Okay. Right. After that, where are you going to manage this patient?
This patient needs inward management.
Yes, because it's a complicated withdrawal. We are expecting, anticipating this man would develop a seizure. We don't know whether he would develop delirium tremens as well, right? So admit, then
assess the severity of the dependence, whether it is moderate or severe. Depending on that, we have to start
chlorodiazepoxide along with thiamine. And after that, to avoid withdrawal seizures, what can you prescribe? The risk is the patient can go for a definite seizure, maybe even during the withdrawal time. So be prepared for prophylactic. Prophylactic benzodiazepines are helpful in this situation. Thank you very much, Diane.
Madam, so we are prescribing chlorodiazepoxide.
Yeah.
And in addition to that, do we have to prescribe another benzodiazepine as a seizure prophylaxis?
Now, if the patient's developing only, we can give. Right now, the patient is in a hospital setting. Right? Sorry, madam. Yeah, short-term phenytoin is using, madam. But not as a prophylaxis. This patient, if the patient's developing seizures, of course, can. That is in the past, madam. Now, this time he is coming, he wants to stop, and then.
Maybe it is perhaps not clear up enough. So, this is in a past episode, sometime back.
Yeah.
The patient has developed withdrawal seizures,
and now he is coming to us, and we have to assess whether we are anticipating a complicated one or not and plan accordingly.
I think what we physiologically see is that the benzodiazepines are perfectly capable of preventing seizures without any anticonvulsants. If you give the right dose, it can definitely, sometimes seizures occur very quickly before the withdrawal symptoms get. Yeah,
that is because the dose is not sufficient.
Excuse me, can I have?
Yes, please.
I am working at a divisional hospital. If some patient came like this as the first seizure presentation, can we treat this patient in our hospital setup where we can't do more investigations at all? Or do we have to transfer to this hospital like that?
If the patient is coming with
Seizures, his first seizure after alcohol.
Yeah, I think so you're in a divisional hospital. They are only, yes, you have the ward facilities. Yes, if you, yes, can treat them now, in case you can't transfer all the patients, and now if you, yes, have fluorodiazepoxide or something to go for a withdrawal, you can, yes, do that, right? But be mindful then, once you start treating these patients, you have to assess quite frequently, right? But most of the instances, you have to see whether these patients are having liver failure. The medical comorbidity is also usually coming with that. Like the severe patients, better to transfer, but doesn't mean that you have to transfer all the patients, right?
Thank you.
If possible, yes. Go ahead.
Yeah, there is another observation.
Excuse me?
Professor Narada Vatansuri again states that there was a neonate who developed withdrawal seizures, and that was attributed to mother's heroin use in UK sometime back. Thank you, sir. I think very rarely. And the reaction of the neonates and young children to opioids might be very different from adults. We do not see withdrawal seizures among heroin users in our clinics and our other settings. It can be with the neonates because the difference in the reaction. So if you are managing a neonate, best to ask for specialist advice. Thank you very much. And there is another observation here, Dr. Asif.
Can I also, yes, add something,
yeah, sure,
to that?
Sure.
Actually, yes, very recently, sir, you can be proud of about the pediatric unit. Very recently, there was a baby born. We have a suspicion that the mother is taking. Actually, the medical officers were able to detect the patient, the baby after giving birth. The baby was very irritable. He was constantly crying, and they suspected the heroin withdrawal in the baby. And that was caught.
Thank you. And there is another statement, Dr. Asit again. Recent increase in the price of Librium is very disturbing. One Librax 5 milligram was ₹30 approximately. SPC1 not available, private sector patients. Okay, diazepam is perfectly all right for any kind of withdrawal when you are managing alcohol withdrawal syndromes. Usually we use diazepam a lot. It's cheap, available, and very effective. So don't worry, go ahead with diazepam. Only thing you need to check is whether there is severe liver damage and having the possibility of a liver failure, where the patients can be very sensitive to long-acting benzodiazepines anyway. In that case, the option of a shorter-acting one like lorazepam is there. Temazepam is not available here. You can use even carbamazepine, which is safe in liver damage, as well as it will not cause respiratory distress, and it is not going to suppress the brain centers. So use diazepam or diazepam. If when it is impossible, you can even go for carbamazepine. So those options are available. And don't worry about prescribing branded Librax or Librium or anything like that. Diazepam is available. That's perfectly fine. That is my comment. Okay. Any other?
Prasanka, are we in the discussion now? You have anything else?
It is finished.
No? Right. Okay. So just one point, Jamal, there. The Librax is a completely different medication. It is chlorodiazepoxide and some antispasmodic combination, which is a fancy drug for irritable bowel syndrome and all that. So Librax is not enough. You have to prescribe Librium. That's the trade name. It's a chlorodiazepoxide. It's not any combination. I don't think chlorodiazepoxide is very expensive. At times not available, then you can prescribe diazepam. One more point is that, the withdrawal seizures is a clinical diagnosis. You don't have to do EEG and MRI to diagnose it. You have a very serious alcohol withdrawal, alcohol dependence history. And when you look at the last drink, and it's within a day or two, or sometimes it may be even more than that, then that's a withdrawal seizure, unless there's any other reason to think otherwise. So, even in a small hospital, you can make a diagnosis. However, word of caution, these people do have multiple comorbidities, so they can die of something else. They may have a stroke, they may have an MI, they may die of something else, and that might be blamed on you. So therefore, my personal advice is that always have some consultant cover. If you are treating a patient with mild alcohol withdrawal, don't worry more than that.
Thank you.
I think there's one more comment. Jamal, the diazepam 10 milligrams equals chlordiazepoxide 25 milligrams. Yeah, it's something like that. Now, diazepam is more potent than chlordiazepoxide. So if you're prescribing chlordiazepoxide, you have to prescribe very, you know, higher doses than diazepam. Okay, so I will, okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Prasanka Seniratna Alas, but please don't leave because the next trigger is also going to be discussed by Dr. Seniratna Alas. I think they are trying to get hold of that trigger.
Sorry, in the meantime, there was one original question posed whether alcohol addiction or dependence is a developmental disorder. So you want to comment on that, whether alcohol dependence is a developmental disorder?
Yeah. I'm not sure what was meant by that.
Whether is it a developmental disorder? Okay, what I have to say is, there is a, if you read the studies and literature, what it says is there is a genetic component to this. People who are susceptible might develop alcohol dependence or any other dependences. Now look at it from a different point of view. In Sri Lanka or in any other society, there are other drugs, which I'm not going to name here, which are readily available, quite addictive. But our youngsters will not take it up. So if it is purely genetic or developmental kind of, then we would see all sorts of dependence producing substances being used by our population, which is not the case. On the other hand, people who take up alcohol very young and who develop dependence early on might have other comorbidities like personality disorders and various genetic predispositions will make them a little bit difficult to come out of those, rather than genetics or the our composition, the physics or the brain chemistry or whatever is the only contributing factor. So mostly it is environmental, because alcohol is available, promoted, heavily promoted, and being put on us from a very young age, only this is prevalent to this extent. And mind you, we have a majority of a population who are abstinent, like close to 80% of Sri Lankans are not drinking. We won't appreciate that fact. And if this were a development disorder, probably you would see a different picture. Anyway, that's what I can add to this. And if you are ready, we can go to the next part now. Thank you.
Okay. So the next video. So during the next video, please try to focus on that. And at the end, the patient might say about his why he has taken cannabis, and you can see how a doctor is interviewing about psychotic symptoms. And the main aim of this presentation is to discuss about the myths around cannabis. We're only talking about cannabis, and this is a real patient taken with the consent. I'm sorry about the background noises, but hope you can listen to the conversation.
දෙතේ නමාරු ඔයාට
මේ කලින් තිබ්බා ටයිස් ගාන විතර කරගන්න ඕන වුණා තිබ්බා ටයිස් ගානවා කුඩු ගා ඒ කියන්නේ කුඩු ගන්නයි අයිස් වැඩිපුරම අයිස්ුයි ගංජායි තමයි පන්නන්නේ ඇපල් ඇපල් පැටි පන්නනවා
ඔව්
ඒ පන්නලා පොල්ලා මගේ මේ මිනිමෙසේ කලින් ඇඟ තිබ්බේ
ඔව්
මගේ ඇඟ කන්නඩින් බලපුවම මං කියන්නේ මං කපා ගත්තා
ඒක කපාගෙන එහෙම තියන්නේ
ඔව් කලින් ඇඟ මේ මිනිමෙ බෙත් තියෙනුන් පච්ච කොටා වෙනුනේ
හා දැන් වා ඒව කරන්න පෙළඹුණේ වා හිතෙන මේ මද්‍රව ගන්න ගත්තට පස්සේ කියලා.
ඔව් ඒක ආර නැති දවස් නැතික නැතිකොට මගේ ඇඟේ අර නිකම්ම ගැවුලන්න පටන් ගන්නවා.
හා
ගාන දෙතනවා වෙන එක්කෙනෙක් මොනවද කිව්වම තරහ වෙත ගන්නද?
කේන්ති යනවා.
කේන්ති යනවා.
හා
ඒක කන්නඩි වලට ගන්නවා.
Tamanta මහානි කර ගන්නවා.
ඔව්
මේ මොකම ආවේ මද්‍රව නැති වුණා තමල්ලාවට.
ඔව්
ගංජා හැමද?
ඔව් නෑ ඒ කියන්නේ
අයිතුයි හැම එකම වගේ දෙන්න.
ඊට පස්සේ මංගන ඉවසගන්න බැරි කමට බෙල්ල වල දාගන්න යන එකයි
යන ඒවා
ඔව් ඒක දවසක් ගිහලා මගේ යාළුවෙක් බේරගත්තා.
හා.
දොසේයත් නැති වුණා මගේ
බයික් ඇක්සිඩන්ට් එකේ. වර්ධන් කේන් තියන ගතිය තියෙනවා. Tamanට හානි කර ගන්න ගතිය අනිත් අයට. මෙහි ආවේ ඒක හින්දද?
ඔව් ඒකින්ද අර මධ්‍ය වේගෙන් නතර කර
ගන්න. නතර කර ගන්න. වැඩි හරියම ගන්න මොනවද?
වැඩි හරියම ගන්න දෙකම තමයි ඒ කියන්නේ දෙකම ගාපුවම තමයි අර එංගට
කලවමට. දැන් ගොඩක් අය එහෙමයි නේද? අයිසුත් එක්ක කලවමට ගන්න. ගංජා. ඔව්. නිකන් මේ ගංජාද කේජීද?
නෑ ඒක වර්ගෙද ගත්තම ඒක ගංජායි කේජී මල් තිනු.
මල්. ඔය මොනවද සාමෙන්?
මන්න වැඩිපුරම ගන්න කේජී.
කේජී. දැන් ගොඩක් මල් අඩුයිනේ මෙහෙම.
ඔව්. ඒකේ ඒකෙත් සීන්
मद्रव गए
දැන් නිදිය ගන්න බෑ ඒ කලින් ඉස්සර
කවුරුද ඉතින් හොල්මන් කියලා එහෙම හිටියද
ඒ කියන්නේ හොල්මන් කියලා නෙමෙයි සර් එංග සම්පූර්ණ කළුපාටින් වාලා
ඔව්
එනිමත් දාලා
කළුපාට
ඔව් මාතයි උසයි
ඔව්
එච්චර කොටයි එච්චරම කොට නැහැ කියන්නේ සාමාන්‍යයෙන් කොටයි එංගෙම තියෙනවා
ඔව්
එල පීන් අනිනවා වගේ දවල් කාලේම ටීවී බලන ඉතින් පිටිපස්සෙන් එන තට්ටු කරනවා මං තනියෙන් ඉද්දි
ඔව්
කට්ටිත් එක්ක ඉද්දි කිසි ගානක්
ඒ කළුපාට ඡායාව නේද ඔව්
ඡායය
ඔඩ 60 පේනවාද ඒක ඉන්න වගේ දැනෙනවා
ඉන්නවගේ ළඟ
දැනෙනවා
හා තනි වෙලා තනියෙන් ඉද්දි දැනෙනවා බය වෙච්චේ
බය ඒ බයයි චකිතින්න ඔය දැන් හිතේ දුකෙන්ද ඉන්නේ
ඔය ඒ කියන්නේ වැටලා ඉන්නේ
හිතේ වැටෙන හේතුව මේ හිතේ බය නින්ද නැති එකද නැත්නම් වෙන මොන හරි ප්‍රශ්නයක්
නැහැ බය කියන්නේ මට හිතෙනවා මගේ ජීවිතේ නැති වෙලා ඇවිත්ලා ඒ වගේ දුක ඇද්දි නිකම්ම
මේ මද්රව ප්‍රශ්නේ හින්ද විනාශ වෙයි කියලා හිතනවා දැන් බය වෙන්න එපා අපි වේද දෙනවානේ දැන් මනෝ වෛද්‍යවරයෙක් වශයෙන් මම මේ අහන ප්‍රශ්නයක් තියෙනවා තව මොනවා කියන මාරු තියෙනවා
ඒ ටික තවත් තියෙන
ඔය ගංජා ගන්න කාලේ එහෙම අහලා තිබ්බද මේ මේ මේවට මානසික රෝග එනවා කියලා
නෑ නෑ සර් ඒ කලින් මම පාවිච්චි කරන දවස් ටිකේ ගංජා කියන්නේ
ඔව්
බේත් වගේ જાතියක් කියලා තමයි කිව්වේ
ඔයාලට එහෙම දැනනද මුලදී
ඒ කියන්නේ මුලදී කියන්නේ ඒ ගාපු ගම්ම අර නිකම්ම අර ඉනා යනවා
ඔව් නේ ඉස්සර හොම් මානසික රෝග තිබ්බලා මේ නෙමෙයිනේ ඔයා
නෑ ඉස්සර නෙමෙයි
පරම්පරාවේ කාටවත් මානසික රෝග තිබ්බද
ඔයා කාටවත් තිබ්බද
තිබ්බේ නෑ
Okay, what is the reason for him to take cannabis in this presentation? What was told?
You want them to respond? Yeah, okay. You can unmute yourself.
All right.
No, you can.
So you, they were. He was told that it's like a medicine, right? Now that is the propaganda going on. Right, widely about promoting cannabis, and I think all of y'all are aware that there's a huge discussions going on about promoting cannabis, and that is one of the common myths about cannabis. Right, this is not a very recent invention. The cannabis has been there in our culture for many years, and now there's a canvassing that to take it as a medicine. So that's why this boy has taken. Right, so mind you, this boy is 19 years old, and he has started cannabis when he was 15 years. So how many years to live? Right, he has developed some of the psychotic symptoms. So at the end, you may have heard that how to elicit psychotic symptoms in a patient who's coming with cannabis withdrawal. And the things that he mentioned at the beginning are not psychotic symptoms. I've seen a black color person and coming and those things, those are illusions. So at the end, he mentioned some of the symptoms, right? So we will discuss about some of the myths and you all can come out with the myths that you have heard. Okay, so when you walk down the streets, it's very difficult to miss these things, right? Every three-wheeler, everywhere, you can see these signs of cannabis sativa leaf, right? Everywhere. So it's becoming very much attached to our culture as well. So the cannabis, now people believe cannabis should be smoked as a medicine, right? If you take cannabis like smoke, it will be a medicine, but nowhere in the world it is considered as medicine, not even have the FDA approval. There are some instances mentioned that resistant seizures can be treated with cannabinoid oil, not with tetrahydrocannabis or this type of other things, right? So even in Ayurvedic medicine, they say they have given in the past, right? It is a treated one, not the original one, because it have some toxicity and causes unnecessary things. So that's why they are also very much cautious about giving that. So it's a wrong belief that people think it should be taken like a medicine, right? Okay, nowhere in this world is being used as a medicine, right? And the calming effect, right? It is very popular. If you see most of the YouTubes, they are advertising that they are telling, motivating people to take, saying that the drug can make you calm, right? Smoking cannabis make you calm. And some people take it, especially these young children, to get this high feeling, right? But the evidence are opposite of that. There's a 6% risk of getting schizophrenia if you take cannabis in the past, heavy quantities, even if it is low quantities, about 3%, right? And the mood disorders, anxiety disorders are very common, not high at the beginning, yes. But that high also depends on the environmental factors and the expectation of the user. For instance, this boy was telling, he was asked to take cannabis as a medicine, right? And then he was told, this is like a medicine, and if you take this, you will get these feelings. You will feel high, you will feel some sort of enjoyment, you will calm yourself. So once you take it, they also try whether they are getting it. Okay, most of the time, with their perspective, if they want to see it like that, they will experience it. Okay, and the creativity also important, right? Most of them is another way, the musician and other people who is in the music industry, they can't write a song or whatever without cannabis, it seems, right? So, but the evidence is, if you take it long time, there's a high risk of getting all these things and the cognitive decline. That it impairs judgment and the motor coordination. Okay, those are the evidence, but people believe things at the beginning and they get addicted to it. And finally, when they can't get rid of that, also, they can't get rid of that, because they are having some sort of a psychosis. So this is the last slide, right? So cannabis have two chemical ingredients. One is cannabidiol and tetrahydrocannabinol, right? This cannabidiol is the one actually prescribed, that is an oil, not a smoke, right? Used for the seizures, but the benefits mentioned here have contradictory evidence, right? If you Google and see, the evidence are sometimes for and against. Okay, so the tetrahydrocannabinol is the one who's causing all these disasters and the people who are taking actually, right? Okay, so because of tetrahydrocannabinol, you get the addiction and all these unwanted effects, psychosis and all these causes. So now you all can come out with the myths that you have heard about cannabis and we can discuss. That's all.
Thank you, Dr. Prasangita. Yes, so the main three myths busted were, I think, that cannabis smoked is a medicine, cannabis is a calming drug, and cannabis increases creativity. So all these myths are rampant and they are propagated. So I think that we need to see if our patients do have these myths, usually all three of them, at least one or two, and to address them and tell them. I mean, patients generally believe what doctors say. So you can just tell them that these are myths and these what really happens. So it's question time. So we can have questions and you can unmute yourself now if you have. I think until questions roll in, I think another myth is that cannabis is anti-tobacco. So tobacco industry doesn't want cannabis popularized. They are, you know, trying their best to keep it illegal and all that. So we need to, if you are going to really fight the tobacco industry and big multinationals, then favor cannabis. So that is again a big myth, because tobacco industry is heavily investing in cannabis industry because they know that it's their new product, next product. So it's the tobacco industry itself. Looks like no questions. Maybe one last invitation to ask questions. Maybe if you want, you can. Yep.
Yeah. Just to add a little bit. One is, I think you can see the last slide, the CBD versus THC comparison, and this is a good example of what we should learn when we are Googling. Now this says THC produces a high, and even the Oxford textbook of psychiatry starts with similar statements. Many users state that they get a high kind of things, however not substantiated or not accompanied by any references, any evidence as we use in medical literature. And we are just told that it gives rise to a high. Now, where is the evidence? What about the double blind experiments? And do we see anything which states, like, you know, when THC or cannabis is given to people who do not know that they are given cannabis, reports a high mood or something like that? That sort of things are not or never found in usual literature we read. So even if you Google for the effects of cannabis, most of the time you will first read very positive statements. And some of the users will actually come up with the similar statements as well. However, we need to be careful, because none of us or none of the users which come across us in our clinics have never had a chance of experimenting with these things as experiments in science. They are primed with psychological preparation in order to expect an effect which they look for continuously, or they themselves develop later because the psychology overrides whatever the chemistry there is in the brain. So that is something which we need to be careful when we are educating the general public on the effects of whatever the drugs we are speaking of. Cannabis is not an exception. So THC not always gives rise to a high. It gives rise to a high as users tell us when they know that they have consumed cannabis. Right? That is the case.
And we'll quickly finish these two questions and we can move on to the next one. Prasanka, how to differentiate if the psychosis is due to cannabis or ice? I think the simple answer is it doesn't matter if they are using both. Anyway, if you want to add anything to that. The other question is how to initiate the management for cannabis users who wants to stop it. It's just counseling or symptomatic treatment?
Treatment, medical treatment, yes. We are not actually giving medical treatment for cannabis. There's no detoxification or anything like that in cannabis, right? So it is mainly psychological. if somebody wants, you can refer them to nearest psychiatric clinic or whatever, to your MO mental health. So they are actually trained about this.
Yeah, I think because they do not develop any serious
withdrawal symptoms.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we don't detoxify them.
But if they do claim any difficulty in sleeping or whatever, you can always give some symptomatic treatment, I guess. I think we can.
Yeah, there is a suggestion from Dr. Aisha Lokubara Surya. Shall we get together to advocate media to stop advertising? Yes, madam, agreed. We are trying our best all the time. But the money seems to be a bit more powerful motivator for people who are working in these fields. But the situation is not very bad in Sri Lanka, right? So there is hope. What steps are being done to overcome the social limitation to cannabis provided by famous artists? Well, thank you for asking that. It's a very difficult situation that people who work in this field are in, because the so-called famous artists are not isolated figures. They are part of a movement which is funded by a multinational organization, the tobacco industry. Huge amount of money seems to be going on. If you connect the dots, you will see the big picture. They are fighting in different fronts with different agendas and targeting different groups of people. For example, they themselves target the artists group using different ways, the youngsters in a different manner, Ayurvedic physicians in another way, and us, the medical doctors who work here as MBBS doctors in a different manner. So we are also being told that there is scientific evidence, then if you dig deeply, that there is no hard evidence as such for the use of cannabis in most medical conditions that they are being advertised to be used as. So the fight is going on. Please join that. Individually also we can do that. People post all these things in social media and commenting on these, asking for evidence, or asking people like you and me to change what we forward would be probably a good starting point, and asking questions and getting together, maybe not formally, and mainly individually, to do something will ultimately develop a good grassroots level force in order to change these things. And even this workshop is part of that. Thank you.